Ashet Books Ireland presents The Anniversary by Roisin Meaney, read for you by Deirdre O'Connell. Wednesday, 26th April. Lily. When the telephone rings, she's reading, or trying to. Her eyes slither across the page, gathering up the words but not taking in the sense of them. She's doing her best to concentrate. But the department circular is as tedious and long-winded as official documents tend to be. Is there a competition to see which of them can bore the fastest? And her head, anyway, is in Land's End, where the rest of her will be in 2 days. And then the telephone rings. It's electronic burr jumping suddenly into her office, causing the document in her hand to give a little answering jump. She lifts the receiver, throwing a glance towards the window that looks out on the schoolyard and the back gate. A room with a view, it is not. Or rather, the view isn't exactly edifying. Yes? It's Enid, her secretary says. She wants to talk to you. She's insisting. Enid, for crying out loud. Her third call this week. Or is it her fourth? Has the woman nothing better to do? Tell her I'm in the middle of something. Say I'll call her back tomorrow. She says it's very important. Lily sighs. It's always very important with Enid. Take a message, Nora. Say I've just gone out. I've already told her you're here, I'm afraid. And there it is again. The polite obstinacy, the almost defiance that Nora usually manages to insert into every one of their exchanges, however brief. Nora hadn't appreciated having her inefficient filing system changed when Lily came to power 7 years earlier. Her manner since then has veered dangerously close to insolent. One of the days, she'll cross the line and Lily will seize her moment and send her packing, union or no union. Right, put her through, but please, hold any other calls until the afternoon. Say I'm in a meeting and can't be disturbed. No exceptions. There's a small click and Enid is on, breathing noisily into Lily's left ear. Big-chested, multi-chinned Enid, the current chairperson of the PTA. A mole to the left of her lower lip sprouts a trio of long, dark hairs that Lily's repulsed gaze is drawn to each time they meet. You'd think she'd bleach them at least, if she can't bring herself to yank them out. Lily lets her wait, her eyes still on the yard, clocking the latecomers, the usual suspects who scurry in every morning. There go the two O'Neills. Couldn't be on time if they tried. Not that they try very hard. And here comes poor old Babs Harty, the last in a long line of Harties, looking as patched together as the siblings that preceded her. A miracle she makes it to school at all, given the chaotic home situation. Those seven unfortunates should have been taken into care years ago, with a mother who drinks like a fish and curses like a sailor, and a father in jail more often than he's out. And now Ivy Lyons is pulling up to the gate in her BMW, right on schedule at 10 past starting time, looking brazenly across the yard to the office window as she drops off her two darlings. Lady captain of the golf club, her husband Victor's restaurant, the only Michelin-starred place for miles around. The Ivies and Victors of the world make their own rules, a wasted exercise trying to challenge them, so Lily doesn't bother. She swivels her chair from the window, regards instead the framed photo of Paul and Thomas on her desk. Enid, what can I do for you? Oh, good morning, Mrs. Murphy. Mrs., never Ms., despite it being employed on every written communication from Lily, despite Ms. L. Murphy, principal, clearly displayed on Lily's office door. Women like Enid have no time for Ms. I'm sorry to bother you again. She isn't. She loves bothering people. She lives for it. But I'm afraid there have been one or two complaints regarding the play the fifth years were taken to see last week. Mannish voice, thick with importance, stuffed full of it. Lily imagines the mole hairs bobbing along as she speaks. I felt I should pass them on to you, Mrs. Murphy. You bet she did. The woman thrives on a bit of controversy. What exactly is the problem, Enid? As if Lily doesn't know exactly what the problem is. I understand there were some profanities. Ah, profanities. The terrible F word. The same F word Lily overhears in the school corridors multiple times every day. Throw it around like confetti, some of them. She turns a deaf ear, or she'd be forever pulling them up. I'm afraid, Enid, I have no control over that. As you know, she probably doesn't. Her darling Conrad not yet in fifth year. The play is on the Leaving Cert programme and as such can hardly be avoided. I can only suggest that the parents take the matter up with the Department of Education and Skills. I can give you contact details if you want them. Silence. Not the correct answer. Lily tilts the photo a fraction to the right, noting how happy her children look in it. Paul is about 3 years old then, which would make Thomas 5 or 6. The two of them on the beach at Land's End, wrapped in Kitty's towels. Wet hair, wide, wide smiles. Paul's adorable little teeth, her freckly face that American guests at the B&B always went mad for. I'll pass that information along then, Enid says eventually, managing to drench the words in resentment. And off she goes to be important somewhere else. Roll on the AGM in September. With any luck, someone new will step up for chairperson and push her off her perch. For the rest of the morning, Lily deals with letters and emails and returns missed phone calls and ploughs through the various circulars in her in-tray. When the bell rings for lunch, she makes her way to the staff room, conscious as she pushes open the door of the usual tiny adjustment among those already assembled. After 7 years at the top, she's well accustomed to the shift of gear her promotion caused. She's not one of them anymore, and they're not about to let her forget it. She's at a loss to understand it. She doesn't throw her weight around. She's fair in her dealings with them. She backs them up when there are problems with parents, even if she privately sides with the parents. But in spite of all this, she's acutely aware that she's not popular. Respected, yes. Liked, not so much. The fact that she's the most efficient principal the school has had in a long time doesn't seem to matter. She tells herself it's for the best. She's their boss, not their friend. Trying to be both would never work. And she has plenty of friends outside school. Lily, a coffee? She sees Yvette by the sink, her deputy, and the closest thing she has to an ally here. Yes, please. She takes a seat and peels the lid from her yogurt tub, recalling the murmurings among the staff when she and Charlie had broken up. Nothing said to her face. Well, she'd never made a formal announcement, knowing they'd hear about it soon enough. And they had. She could tell in the more considered way they looked at her, in the low voice conversations that tapered off whenever she appeared. And when Chloe entered the equation, they heard that too. The news didn't take long to spread, some no doubt delighting to be passing it on. Lily ignored the pitying glances, pretended she didn't hear the occasional sniggers. She told herself it was the price she paid for having climbed to the top of her profession, forgetting the more generous payslip each fortnight. Phew! The vet deposits two mugs on the table and lowers herself slowly into the chair beside Lily. Remind me how many more decades to the weekend. That tough? The younger woman gives a smile that's more of a grimace. Counting the hours at this stage, if I'm honest. 8 months pregnant with her fourth child. Going out on maternity leave in 9 days. Her husband Eddie is a painter and decorator. In theory, if not exactly in practice. Not a great name as a worker. And Lily has overheard staff room whispers of him enjoying the drink a bit too much. She pays no heed to the whispers. Never has. You all set for the weekend? Yvette asks. As set as I'll ever be. I am thinking of heading off a bit early on Friday, maybe around 2. Will you hold the fort? I will, of course. She's blessed with Yvette. Reliable and conscientious. But when she goes out, Lily will be left with Marion, next in line, and the obvious choice to step up. The only problem with this is that Marion and work have never been properly acquainted. Marion is the last to arrive each morning. Traffic was dreadful again. And the first to vacate the car park after school. And Lily has been forced on more than one occasion to talk to her about parental complaints of uncorrected homework and erratic testing. Roll on Yvette's return. Sadly, not till January. After lunch, she meets with a couple whose son isn't doing as well as they'd hoped and tries, without being too blunt, to make the point that it might have something to do with the fact that he's not as intelligent as they'd hoped. The mother becomes tight-lipped. The father huffs and puffs. None so blind as devoted parents with big ambitions for their rather dull offspring. When she finally gets rid of them, 15 minutes before the end of the school day, she checks her silenced mobile and sees a missed call from Agneta, who's left a voicemail. Of course she has. Lil, I've found the most adorable florist. You'll have to meet her. She does amazing bouquets. Call me. The trouble is, Lily couldn't give a damn about bouquets, amazing or otherwise. The difficulty here is that she wants a quiet wedding. Her second, in her 50s. Who makes a fuss about that? Whereas Agneta wants precisely the opposite. Lily is sorry she ever told her she was getting married again. But of course she had to be told, because Agneta will be the only non-family member there on the day. If she'd only stop trying to turn it into something Lily doesn't want it to be. She'll return the call tonight, and she'll be persuaded to go and meet the adorable florist. And no doubt she'll end up ordering a horrendously expensive bouquet that'll be in the bin a few hours after she marries Joe. Unless Agneta whisks it off to be frozen or dried or something. Yes, she can see that happening. How on earth did they ever become friends, let alone the very best of friends? She tidies her desk and checks the time. 8 minutes before she needs to take up her position by the back door to monitor the going home behavior. Usually a vet's job, but Lily took over a couple of weeks ago when standing for any length of time became an issue for her deputy. She sits back and closes her eyes and returns to the weekend ahead of her and travels in her mind's eye to Land's End. 6 of them, 2 couples and 2 singles, to be divided between the 5 bedrooms. Thomas is easy. He'll take the small back twin. Charlie, she knows, will be hoping for the green room with its sea view, the one that was Lily's growing up, the one he and Lily were allotted after the children outgrew the summer holidays at Land's End, and Kitty reclaimed her family bedroom at the top of the stairs. The green room is pretty, the second best in the house. He'll want it, but he's not getting it. She'll put him in the back double beside Thomas. Nice, quiet corner room with 2 windows. And let Paul and Aiden have the green room. If he complains, she'll say she thought Aidan should have the sea view for his first day at Land's End. Nothing he can object to there. Which leaves her and Joe in the main bedroom. Of course it does. Where else would they go? It's just... Stop. Don't be ridiculous. It's a bedroom, that's all. It's a bed, and a wardrobe, and a chest of drawers, and a wingback chair, all of which have seen better days. And a bedside rug that came from America nearly 50 years ago. And a beautiful bay window that looks out on the Atlantic. It's the room her grandparents slept in, and after them her parents. And now it's Lily's turn and Joe's. His first time to stay overnight at Land's End, and if her plans for the place work out, probably his last. Her plans for the place. As if she was embarking on a big project, when nothing could be further from the truth. Her decision hasn't been arrived at lightly. Plenty of soul searching and sleepless nights went into it. What she's planning will be no cause for celebration. On the contrary, she expects her news to be received with some dismay. But it does seem the only logical way forward. She feels a tiny bit guilty, keeping Joe in the dark along with the others. They're getting married in a matter of months, pledging to spend the rest of their lives together. They're already sharing her house in the city. He moved in last December. So it's hardly fair not to let him in on this now. Then again, he has no ties to Land's End, no sentimental attachment at all to it. No. Best to wait and tell them all together. At dinner on Saturday, maybe, when everyone's finally landed. Yes, that should work. In the meantime, there's the main bedroom. There's her mental block with the main bedroom. In 26 years of marriage, she and Charlie never slept there. With her mother still in residence, it simply wasn't an option. And by the time it became necessary to move her out, Lily and Charlie were well separated. And now, Mam is dead. Gone from them 6 weeks ago. Slipping away as they sat around her nursing home bed, with its awful shiny blue coverlet. And even though it's been 2 years since she occupied the bedroom at Land's End, it will still feel like hers. It will still smell like hers. Everything in it will be a reminder of her. Nonsense. It's just a room. Get over it. At least Chloe isn't coming. Be grateful for small mercies. Although, as mercies go, Chloe's absence from the weekend gathering is a pretty humongous one. She opens her eyes and checks the time. She tidies her desk and leaves the office and makes her way to the back door. Paul. She moles a nose, easing it out carefully from the globe of the face, forming its curves and dips and little whirls. The clay is cool and wonderfully smooth. She inhales its wet, slightly metallic scent, feels it at the back of her throat, can almost taste it. A smell she's grown to love. A smell that never fails to lift her to a more contented place. Not her favorite smell of all, though. That has to be the sharp, almost antiseptic perfume of the sea that tumbles onto the pebble beach not 100 yards from the front gate of Land's End, and the seaweed that washes up with it. The scent that inhabits the house, too, lodging in every nook and cranny, so even lying in bed there, she feels like she's floating on water. 2 years, more than two, since she set foot in the place. But not a single day has gone by since then when it hasn't wandered into her thoughts. She can still call it perfectly to mind when she closes her eyes, the big, sprawling blue house by the sea. She can walk through it in her head, identifying every bump in the wall, every threadbare bit of carpet, every creaking floorboard, and now she craves to see it again in reality, and she will see it again, the day after tomorrow. The thought prompts a great joyous leap in her chest. She's going back, and she can't wait, even while the prospect of the visit has her completely torn, even if it will also be drenched in sadness. Land's End without Gran in it, without even the possibility of ever seeing Gran in it again, isn't something she can dwell on for long. But still she wants to go. Now more than ever, she wants to walk through the rooms and remember all the good times. Tea? She turns. Emma is at the sink filling the kettle. Go on. Lemon and ginger? Vanilla chai, thanks. She dips her fingers into the bucket of water that sits at her feet. She rubs her palms together and turns her attention to the mouth. Today, she's working on Felicity, a 64-year-old matron in a busy maternity hospital who dreams of riding a camel across the Gobi Desert. Felicity can be sharp-tongued, particularly with the younger nurses. But she'll stay past clocking off time, long past, if anyone needs her. When she was 15, Felicity fell in love with her Spanish teacher, who didn't reciprocate. She never found anyone else, unless you count Gregory. On her days off, Felicity dresses up and goes dancing in the afternoons with Gregory, who paved her driveway one sunny, long-ago summer, and who's been trying to get her to marry him for the last 20 years. Paul names every head, gives each of them a story. It makes them feel real to her as she forms their features, as she carves out earlobes and decides on eyebrows and noses and cheekbones. The only problem with creating lives for them is that she misses them when they're complete, when she has to let them go and move on to the next. Sometimes she finds herself thinking about them, wondering if they've ended up in good homes. Where is Belinda, the 12-year-old asthmatic prodigy who speaks 5 languages and who's already read Anna Karenina in the original Russian? It wouldn't be everyone who could handle Belinda. And what about Tavius? At 113, the oldest man in Ireland, still swimming in the sea every day. Poor Thaddeus wouldn't be happy in the middle of a city, not at all. They all take time and lots of patience. This is her 5th attempt at Felicity. It's not always easy, getting the features to match the image in her head, the image that she can see so clearly in her mind's eye. But once she gets there, worth all the false starts. Once she gets there, they can almost talk to her. They can almost breathe. The tea is made. She cradles her mug, inhaling cinnamon. Did I mention how much I can't wait for the weekend?
Once or twice.
Emma tucks dark brown hair behind an ear, leaving a turquoise streak on the lobe.
2 sleeps to go. Family group, though. You sure you can handle it?
I can handle it. We all get on fine.
More or less. More with Mum, less with Dad. Fine with Thomas.
Remind me, has Aidan ever seen the house? The mention of his name brings a glad skip of her heart. No, this'll be his first time. And maybe his last. The notion courses through her like a shard of ice.
It's by the sea, isn't it?
That's right, about 30 minutes west of Galway.
Nice. Bit chilly yet for a swim, though.
I'll pack the togs, just in case.
Of course she'll swim. You can't go to Land's End and not swim.
Your ear is blue, by the way.
Emma blows on her tea. Duly noted, thanks.
Her ears and other exposed parts are generally quite colourful by the time she finishes her day. Emma turns photos of people's houses or their gardens or their children or their pets into beautiful watercolour images. She has a waiting list, but takes her time with each commission. She can afford to.
Her husband, Tom, runs his own successful courier company. For the long weekend, they're flying to New York and staying in an apartment overlooking Central Park and turning the weekend into a week. The studio belongs to Emma. She and Paul met in hospital 5 years earlier when Emma underwent an emergency appendectomy on the same day that Paul had her tonsils out. After their respective surgeries, they ended up in neighbouring beds. And when Paul mentioned, somewhere along the way, that she'd recently graduated from art college and was looking for studio space, Emma offered to share. "I don't need the rent," she said, "but someone to chat to over a cuppa when I take a break would be nice. The rest of the time, I have to have complete silence. No talk, no music, no radio. You okay with that?" Paul was okay with that. More than okay. She couldn't imagine conversing with anyone while she created her heads. It would be like inviting someone she hardly knew into the bathroom to watch her brush her teeth. The arrangement suits them both perfectly. They work in the same space 5 days a week, and if asked, Paul would say they're friends. But neither of them has ever suggested going for a drink after they finish up. And no cards or gifts are exchanged at Christmas or for birthdays. Their relationship is primarily a business one, with 2 10-minute chats thrown in each day, during which time details of their respective lives trickle out. It works for both. They finish the tea and resume their silent labours. Paul works on Felicity's smile, pokes a dimple into a cheek, tweaks the eyes to give them a more melancholic quality. Maybe the matron is thinking of all the babies she's delivered down the years, or the ones she never had herself. Maybe she's pondering Gregory's latest gift, a diamante brooch in the shape of a teddy bear that she'll definitely only be wearing on their dancing afternoons. Generous, clueless Gregory. If he'd only stop trying so hard, she might say yes. He doesn't need to set her world on fire. She gave up hoping for that a long time ago. This Felicity is working. This Felicity might be the one. Pottery is Paul's salvation. Working with clay keeps her demons at a safe distance. At work, she can believe herself happy. She is happy, or as happy as she can ever be. Aiden makes her happy too, of course. Or he used to, until the demons got wind of it and decided that enough was enough. She's fighting them like she always fights them. But she's never beaten them yet, and she isn't hopeful now. As she refines Felicity's chin, she scrolls back in her head and calls up her first encounter with Aiden. She can remember every word of the conversation. She was 2 years out of college, sharing a house with a couple of friends, and working 3 evenings a week and every weekend in the bar of a small hotel owned by acquaintances of her parents. The work was easy enough, and the wages covered her bills, her clay, and other knick-knacks required for the heads. But with weekdays spent in Emma's studio, she was left with precious little free time. She was also running out of space to store her heads. She made every effort to find customers for them. She took photos and posted them on social media and asked everyone to share. She gave sample heads to friends who promised to display them in their workplaces. She took a stall at any craft event that came up. She did what she could to spread the word, but sales remained sporadic and brought in a pittance. Whenever one of her parents, usually Mum, asked about finding an official outlet for her work, Paul would say she was still building up a collection, when in reality, her collection was well and truly built. "You'll have to find a gallery to take them," Emma told her. "You're a hopeless businesswoman. You should be asking 3 times the price." "What? But I can hardly sell them as it is." "That's because the right people aren't seeing them. You should call to that gallery on Portland Avenue. Tom and I have got some lovely stuff there." Paul cringed at the thought of visiting a gallery, any gallery, but particularly the one on Portland Avenue. She admired it as she passed on her way to the studio each day. It looked classy and terribly expensive, with its pale grey facade and burgundy door, and its pieces of pottery and jewellery beautifully presented on glass shelving inside the window. She'd never ventured in. She'd have liked a browse, but she felt intimidated by its polished appearance. "I don't think my stuff would fit in there," she said. "It's not posh enough." "Rubbish. No such thing as posh art. It's all in the eye of the beholder. Your heads are delightful. Lots of people would adore them. Come on, you have nothing to lose by trying. And the owner's friendly. Imagine if you could earn enough from sales of your heads. You could give up the bar work and have a bit of a life outside here." Making a living from her art. It was the dream, wasn't it? It was so wonderful it almost scared her. Wasn't it worth putting herself through a bit of mortification to pull her dream a little closer? She deliberately made no contact with the gallery owner in advance of her visit. "Just turn up," Emma advised. "Easy to put you off in an email if he's busy. He'll be curious to see what you have to offer if you call there in person." She decided to bring along three of her favourite pieces. She had it all worked out, her script prepared in her head. And on the day, nothing went to plan. As she approached the gallery, an emerging man pushed the door open with some force. Paul stepped back hastily to avoid a collision, but the edge of the door struck the cardboard box she was carrying, knocking it out of her grasp. And her precious pieces, Hattie and Gordon and Chester, the three she was most proud of, were smashed to smithereens. She subsequently disgraced herself by weeping without restraint in the middle of a rather chilly afternoon until the owner emerged with a paper cup of water and ushered her inside, waving off the still apologizing man who'd caused the catastrophe. When she'd recovered her senses somewhat, she saw a wide mouth, dark-rimmed glasses, a flop of sandy hair. He gave a tilt of his head towards the box, which she still clutched. "I'm guessing the contents were breakable." She nodded, not yet trusting herself to speak, blotting at her face with her sleeve. She could hardly look at him. Talk about making a fool of herself before they'd even met properly. "So what was it?" "Pottery. I make heads from clay." God, even that sounded ridiculous. Her script had fled from her mind the minute the box crashed to the ground. "Clay heads," he repeated. "Human heads."
"Yes, but smaller. Caricatures, really."
"Are they mounted?"
"Yes, at least they have a wooden base, but they're on springs. They sort of bob."
"Bobbing heads?" For the first time, he smiled. A sudden beam that softened his entire face. He no longer looked stern. He looked lovely. It gave her courage.
"It makes them seem more alive. When they can move, I mean."
"I'm sure it does. Do you have any pictures on your phone?" Yes, she had plenty. But when she searched for her phone, it was to discover, to her horror, that she'd left it behind at the studio. Talk about seeming even more amateurish. Still, he didn't look put out. "I assume you have others, though." She took him in properly for the first time. Greenish eyes, or between brown and green. Copper might be a better description. Or bronze. The glasses looked expensive. All of him looked expensive. And then, inevitably, the demons kicked in.
"Look around," they said. Couldn't she see his gallery was far too classy for her clownish heads? He must be accosted every other day by idiots like her, hoping to impress him with their pathetic endeavors. "Get out," they urged her, before she completely humiliated herself. He was waiting. She had to say something.
"I'm sorry,
I think I might have got it wrong. Suddenly, she wanted to get away, bury this awful episode and forget about it forever. The bar work wasn't that bad. Only a handful of artists made a living from their art. How conceited to imagine she might be one of them. Why don't you let me be the judge of that? He asked. Can you call by tomorrow with some more? He still wanted to see them. He wanted her to come back. The demons were momentarily silenced. Yes, she said, trying not to let an idiot grin erupt on her face. Cordelia, she was thinking, and Jason, and maybe Heather. When? What time would suit? Around now would be fine. Thank you, she said, for your help, I mean. No trouble. And for agreeing to look at my work. It's what I do, he said. Another smile. He had a really good smile. He hadn't asked her name. She didn't know his. I'm Paul Cunningham, she said, putting out a hand. His grip was firm. Aidan Grimes. Good to meet you, Paul. See you tomorrow. When she returned to the studio, Emma was out. She salvaged what she could from the destroyed heads. Two turquoise buttons, a pink feather, the gold wire she'd used for Hattie's hoop earrings, the strands of orange string that were Chester's hair, and binned the rest. She deliberated over the 47 remaining heads in her collection, choosing first one, then another, selecting and rejecting until she couldn't think straight. Finally, she went with her original choices. Shy, blushing Cordelia, dog trainer, happier around animals than with humans. 60-plus Jason, retired librarian, amateur detective, clandestine cross-dresser, and little, freckly, chuckling Heather, at 2 years old, the youngest of her creations. She packed them up, more bubble wrap, a lot more bubble wrap, and presented them to Aidan Grimes the following day. And in the time it took for him to enthuse over them and to suggest that she bring three more so he could exhibit half a dozen for a 6-week trial period, in the time it took him to suggest a selling price that was 4 times what she'd envisaged, and to make her an excellent coffee to seal the deal, she fell in love with him. Love always took her by surprise. It happened fast. But love was her enemy as much as her friend. Countless times her heart has been broken. Countless times she's vowed to avoid love forevermore, to run in the other direction whenever she senses its arrival. But the stupid truth is that love isn't the enemy. She is. The stupid, senseless reality is that she's always the one to call time on the relationships. Over and over again she walks away, compelled by something, some inner voices, yes, some demons, that insist she put an end to things.
You don't deserve to be happy, the voices whisper. You are not good enough for him. Walk away before he finishes with you.
Coward that she is, she does eventually walk away, because the voices, the demons, Hester and torment her until she does. But then Aidan happened to her. Love struck again. 7 months after she'd said goodbye to John, her last boyfriend, leaving him mystified as to her reason, leaving her unable to explain why. 1 year after she fell for Aidan, 1 year of the heads beginning to sell, 1 year of them gaining steady sales, 1 year of her silently loving him, he asked her out. 3 months after that, she spent her first night in his apartment. Now they've been together for over 2 years, longer than any of her previous relationships. And just when she thought they might have got fed up and moved on, the demons are beginning to whisper again. And she's afraid. She's 26 and completely in love, and horribly afraid. She doesn't want to end it. Everything in her rebels at the thought of ending it. How can she walk away from him when everything he says, everything he does, makes her heart full? How can she say goodbye when he's the other half of her? The half that makes sense of the rest. What is wrong with her that she can't allow herself to be happy? Is she destined to spend her life alone? She's going to ask Gran when she gets to Land's End. She's going to hunt down Gran's spirit or essence or whatever you want to call it. She's going to ask her to help. She's not going to give up Aiden lightly, not without a real fight. But she does need help. And if anyone can help her, it's Gran. Her beloved Gran, who called her Pollywall when she was small and taught her how to make omelets when she was old enough to beat eggs and grate cheese. Gran, who braided Poll's impossible hair so it twined down behind her like a thick burnt orange rope and ended in a beautiful sky blue ribbon. It was Gran who said that her eyes were the colour of the sea on a stormy day, which made grey sound so much less boring. It was Gran who said that her freckles were signs of beauty and that her smile was magic. It was Gran who told her, when Paul sobbed on her shoulder after each teenage tragedy, that it was for the best. You weren't right for each other. That's why it finished. Someday, you'll find the right one. You'll find him or he'll find you. And when that happens, you'll know. When I met your granddad, I knew. But Gran didn't know about the demons. Paul was too embarrassed to tell her. She pretended, after every breakup, that the boy had finished it, not her. It didn't feel like a lie because she felt exactly as sad as if he had. It was the only thing she hid from Gran. But she'll tell her everything now. She'll find a way to tell her about the voices, and Gran will know how to silence them. For the rest of the day, she refines Felicity's features. Yes, this is the one, tweaking every line and curve. When she's satisfied with it, she uses a darning needle to poke careful holes all over the scalp for the spirals of thin copper wire that will serve as hair once the drying and firing is over. Felicity, sadly, has hair like Paul's own, frizzy and infuriating. She fashions the hat, a green felt beret to perch on top. She transfers the head carefully to the sheet of wire mesh that lies on the slatted table by the dehumidifier. She cleans up and says a whispered goodbye to Emma, who paints on. She walks home. Just before 6, in the kitchen of Aiden's apartment, our apartment, he insists, but she still calls it his in her head. She chops vegetables into matchsticks and takes 2 salmon darns from the fridge. She brings a pan of water to the boil and slides in the fish. She adds a tablespoon of coconut oil to the wok, and while it pools into liquid, she phones Aiden. Dinner in 10. Great. Starving. He disconnects with a click. He's not a phone chatter. She adds vegetables to the wok, imagining him 5 streets away, gathering up keys, slinging on his navy linen jacket. She pictures him pressing numbers on the alarm pad and locking the door, hearing the many dead bolts click into place. She sees him pulling down the metal shutters, keeping all his beautiful, precious things safe. Now he's turning onto the street. There's the soft, hurried tap of his leather-soled shoes on the concrete as he passes the deli and the off-license and the halal butcher shop, whose scrubbed facade still shows echoes of the red paint that's thrown regularly at it. Now he walks past the children's boutique with its tiny, ludicrously priced clothes and the narrow little alteration shop run by 2 glamorous women from somewhere in Eastern Europe. Sisters, they must be, with those identical noses, although one is tiny and the other is taller than Aiden. In and out of light and shadow he passes, under the dapple of leaves on the laurel trees that line Portland Avenue. Now he turns the corner to pass the park on his left with its silver-painted railings and the school on his right with its faded green and white bunting flying in the yard, and the church beside it, and the priest's house beside that, its garden full of rose bushes. The journey is so familiar to her, she could do it blindfolded. Gran never saw the gallery. Hall would have loved to bring her, would have loved to show her the walls of paintings, the shelves of delicate, fragile objects. Even if she didn't understand what she was looking at, mightn't she have appreciated the works of art on some level? Wasn't she entitled to a chance for them to gladden her poor, befuddled heart? And wouldn't she surely have recognized Paul's own creations, nestling among the rest, a card attached to each that gave the character's story, with Paul Cunningham Potter on the reverse? Paul had given her one of her first heads, Josephine, the sheep farmer, for Land's End. She had bobbed on Gran's bedroom windowsill for years before accompanying her to the nursing home. But it had never happened. Gran had never got to see the gallery, and Paul knew it would never happen, however much she wanted it to. She shakes the wok, making everything tumble. She arranges cutlery and condiments on the table. She lifts the fish pieces carefully from the water and plates them, and covers them with tinfoil. She hears the sound of the front door, followed by his quick tread on the stairs. She smiles at the wok as she waits to see him, happiness fluttering like a caged butterfly inside her. She thinks about Saturday, when he closes the gallery for the long weekend, and follows her to Land's End. But he hadn't seemed all that enthused, had he, when she mooted the trip a couple of weeks ago. "I thought we might just do nothing," he said. Didn't he say that? Yes, but then he agreed. "Only to keep you quiet. He doesn't want to go. It's the last place he wants to go. Stop it! Stop it! Shut up!" The door opens. "Hello, beautiful," he says. She turns and gives him a bright, bright smile. Thomas. "I was just wondering," she says, "if you'd be interested in something. You mightn't be bothered, it mightn't be your cup of tea at all, but I won tickets, 2 tickets, on the radio the night before last, or was it the one before that? Anyway, it doesn't matter. And, well, I've already asked Michelle, and she would go. She'd really enjoy it. Only Saturdays are book club night, and she was the one who chose the last book. They take it in turns, so she can't very well not show up. And I might have persuaded Mam to go, only she's not really that mobile at the moment after her hip. And anyway, she's not a great fan of concerts. Well, any kind of show, really. So I just said I'd run it by you. And, of course, you mustn't feel at all obliged. It wouldn't bother me a bit if you wouldn't fancy it. Honestly, no pressure." And all the while she's scrubbing out one of the soup saucepans, digging in there with her brush as if her life depended on it, not once looking his way. He can get the gist of it. She won a pair of tickets to a concert, and she's looking for someone to use the second. But she's certainly taking her time getting to the point. He lifts the last chair onto a table and begins to sweep the floor. "What kind of show is it?" She gives an odd kind of sound halfway between a cough and a giggle. "Gods, silly me, I forgot the important bit." Dill splashing about in the saucepan, which must by now be the cleanest it's ever been. "It's called a summer medley. 3 classical composers. Wagner and Bach and someone else. Who is it? Anyway, the pieces are being performed by a visiting orchestra from Poland, I think. Liszt, that's the 3rd. Like I say, it mightn't be your thing at all, and if it's not, don't give it another thought." Despite his father's attempts to interest them in classical music as kids, Thomas isn't a huge fan. He quite liked Fantasia when Dad put on the video, but more for the cartoons than the music. He's not a big concert goer either. The last one he attended with Sam and Matt, a jazz night fundraiser for a suicide prevention charity, must have been well over a year ago. But why not attend this one with Frida? A couple of hours won't kill him, and she's easy company. He thrusts the brush under a table and brings out a fork and bends to retrieve it. Sure, I'll go. That'd be nice. When he straightens up, she's beaming at him.
Oh, would you, Thomas? Really? Are you positive?
Absolutely.
You're not just coming to please me, because I really don't...
No, I'd like it. He might like it. He won't rule out the possibility.
Well, that would be great. Thanks a million.
She sets the saucepan on the draining board and reaches for the next, the smile still wide on her face.
It's actually my birthday that day. Total coincidence.
Is it really? He couldn't have said when her birthday was, although she knows his is in November. Every year for the past four, ever since he started working in the cafe, he's got a card from her. She must have asked him when it was sometime and filed the information away. He feels ashamed now that he didn't know hers.
Why did he never make it his business to find out?
She gives another little laugh, darts him another glance. I'll be the big pre-O, imagine. Hertie, a few months older than him. He would have thought younger. There's something childlike in the way she looks at the world. A lack of cynicism. A genuine belief in the innate goodness of others. Open to abuse, of course. She's had her trust shaken by customers who occasionally duck out without paying. By a man who grabbed her bag on the street once. By bogus gutter cleaners who took her money in advance of the job and disappeared. But it doesn't alter her innate faith in her fellow humans. Such an outlook would probably be scoffed at by many, but Thomas finds it appealing.
So, where's the concert on?
In the Arts Centre. Really looking forward to it. Actually, I love classical music. Another thing he didn't know about her. The music she plays in the cafe is generally a safe mix of the likes of Ed Sheeran and Michael Bublé, Imelda May and Harry Styles. And when is it on?
This Saturday. I know it's short notice, but I hope that's okay.
This Saturday? He stops sweeping. I'm so sorry, Frida, he says. I won't be here. I'm going away for the weekend, remember? The family thing? I'm sure I mentioned it. Her smile stays in place, but all the light ebbs from it.
Oh, yes, she says. You did mention it. I'd completely forgotten.
It's painful to watch the disintegration of her happiness. He feels terrible.
Don't give it another thought, she says,
running fresh water into the second saucepan, taking up the pot scrub.
It makes no odds. It's not as if I paid for them.
Grub, scrub.
I'm sorry to let you down. If it was any other, honestly, it doesn't bother me at all, Thomas. Don't worry a bit about it.
Of course it bothers her. It's plain to see how much it bothers her.
Is there no one else who's free?
Doesn't she have other friends? Michelle is the only one he's met. She worked, still works, in the hospital canteen where Frida started out, but Michelle talks, whenever Thomas encounters her, about quitting. Not exactly full of the joys.
There must be someone else you could ask. Not really. Nobody I can think of. But I'll go on my own. I don't mind.
He watches as she hoiks up a slipping down sleeve and runs a forearm across her forehead, water dripping from the tips of her blue rubber gloves. He doubts she'll go to the concert. Despite her cheery demeanor in the cafe, he senses that, like him, she lacks the kind of courage, the confidence, that would allow her to attend a social event without a companion. He feels a stab of real pity for her. So big-hearted, so eager to make someone else happy, and here he is, disappointing her. But what can he do? It's not as if he can switch the Land's End trip to another weekend.
She rinses the saucepan and sets it on the draining board beside the other. She fixes him with a wide, empty smile.
Do you want to take Saturday off? I know Arthur isn't going anywhere. He could fill in.
For a second, he's tempted. More time at Land's End would be good. He could take it out of his holidays. He has plenty left. And her cousin Arthur has stepped in before for Thomas. It wouldn't be a big deal. But Saturday is her 30th birthday, and she won tickets to a concert, like a birthday present from the universe. And she can't use them. The least Thomas can do is be around during the day, try to make it special if he can.
I'm happy to work on Saturday, thanks. There's only so much family time I can take.
She laughs, or tries to.
I know what you mean.
He'll make it up to her. He'll say nothing on Saturday morning, let on he's forgotten it's her birthday. He'll wait until the cafe is full at lunchtime, and then he'll surprise her. He'll raid the little box of pastel-coloured birthday candles that she keeps in a drawer, just in case she ever overhears a customer being wished a happy birthday. To date, the candles have lain undisturbed in the drawer. Glorious Food isn't the kind of place you'd come to for a birthday celebration. It's more an everyday breakfast or lunch spot. But Thomas will finally put some of them to use on Saturday. He'll stick it into a muffin. He'll do what she would if ever the opportunity arose. Or he might buy her a cake. Yes, that would be better. He'll get her a lemon drizzle, her favourite. He can nip out mid-morning and cut across to the bakery on the next street. He'll stick 3 candles into it, 1 for each decade. And he'll ask one of the regulars to start a chorus of happy birthday. He can give her that much. She lays the saucepan on the draining board and peels off the rubber gloves.
It's your mother's place, isn't it, where you're going?
Yeah.
She pats the saucepan dry with a tea towel. I presume this'll be her first time back there since your gran's funeral.
It will be, yes.
It'll be tough for her.
Well, for all of you, but for her especially.
Thomas thinks about that. Mum has never been one to show much emotion, never one for the heart-to-heart conversations. When he and Paul were growing up, Dad had been the one for the bedtime stories, the one who gave treats after good report cards, the one who brought them from door to door on Halloween nights and helped them eat the treats afterwards. It wasn't that Mum didn't care. It wasn't that at all. She was just the more practical parent. She was the organiser of days out, the lunchbox packer, the holiday planner, the one who sewed name tags onto school uniforms and made sure they wore PE gear on the right day and took time off school to bring them to their dental appointments. She didn't cry when Gran died, or at least not when they were all there. When the 4 of them were gathered around the nursing home bed, and Gran took a few rattly breaths and then went quiet. None of them cried much, apart from Paul, who can generally be relied on to cry at any remotely emotional occasion. But this trip to Land's End was Mum's idea, so she must be feeling loss of some kind, mustn't she? She must be looking for consolation or closure or something. We used to go there as kids on holidays, he tells Frida, wanting to share with her, wanting to make amends for letting her down. It's lovely, right by the sea. My great-grandfather built it. It's big. He wanted loads of kids, and he had them. But they all emigrated to the States except for 1 daughter, and that was Gran.
And she inherited the house?
Yeah. She never left it. My grandfather moved in there when they got married. Gran turned the place into a B&B after he died, and she ran it for years. It wouldn't be very classy by today's standards. None of the bedrooms had ensuite bathrooms. Still don't. But we loved it. And she was always full in the summer. Americans especially went mad for it.
He wonders suddenly if Mum and Dad had paid Gran anything to stay at Land's End.
5 or 6 weeks they'd spend there each summer, taking over her family room, denying her that income. He and Paul had slept in bunks, Mum and Dad in the double bed across the floor. Such a tight unit they were then, the four of them. The breakup of his parents' marriage had come as a complete shock to Thomas. He'd accepted their coupledom as a given, as much a fixture as the house they'd lived in for most of their married life, the home that he and Paul had grown up in. He'd never questioned their relationship. Why would he? They'd always seemed content with one another. He'd seen no indication that either of them wanted out. And then, abruptly, it was gone. Over dinner in a local restaurant, his parents broke it to him and Paul that it was to be no more, that they were to be no more. That was a shock. No use saying otherwise. It had taken some digesting. It had caused a shift in his mindset, an unsettling realization that even the most apparently solid edifices could crumble and collapse without warning. But time had passed, and he'd got used to the new way of things. Not long before the split, he'd moved in with his friend Sam and Sam's partner, Matt, and he'd just started working with Frida in the cafe. Life was busy. Whole days could go by without the changed situation crossing his mind. And then Paul would ring, crying down the phone to him, needing to pull it all apart again, and he'd feel newly astonished that it could even have happened. And the way Mum and Dad seemed to take it in their stride, as if long-married couples separated every day. A number of them did, of course. More than a few of his classmates at school had had divorced parents. He'd always assumed extenuating circumstances, drink or unfaithfulness or other unhappy situations. His own parents' lives were so ordinary. But maybe that was where the problem had lain. Maybe one or both of them had needed more than ordinary. And then, 6 months later, his father invited him and Paul to drinks at the apartment and introduced them, half proudly, half warily, to Chloe. And Tom's world had shifted on its axis again. He regards Frida, scrubbing now at the countertop where they prep the food. There is a slight inward cast to one of her pale blue eyes that lends, he always thinks, an air of faint bewilderment to her demeanor. Her nose is a fraction too large, with a small bump across its bridge. Her smile, often seen, pokes a dimple into a rosy cheek. If not classically beautiful, hers is a face with a pleasing openness and warmth. In physique, she's as different from Thomas as it's possible to be. Where he's long and gangly, she's short and round of shoulder and solidly built, with a broad back and wide hips, and calves that protrude stoutly from the longish skirts she favours. In every way, she is the polar opposite to Chloe. Porcelain-skinned, elfin, poised, stylish Chloe, who touches a violin and breathes magic into it. Even Thomas, with his limited musical ear, can appreciate the depth of her skill. Chloe, who smells of roses, whose small nose tips up adorably, whose teeth are creamy white and perfect. Chloe, who clothes her slender frame in layered tunics and wraps made of a fabric so gossamer fine that they billow out gently behind as she moves, and trousers that taper to a stop at her dainty ankles, and soft-looking pixie boots with buttons and bows. Chloe, the nymph, whose face has taken up residence in his head. Chloe, the perfect creature, who floats into his dreams at night, tantalizing him. Chloe, who is never far from his thoughts. Chloe, who lives with his father. Chloe, who has replaced his mother in his father's affections. He is in love with his father's partner. It's like something you'd see on Jerry Springer. It would be laughable if it wasn't chipping away at his heart. It would be funny if it wasn't tearing him to pieces. They finish cleaning up. They remove their aprons, bottle green, with Gloria's food embroidered in gold on one pocket, and get their things. Outside the cafe, Thomas pulls down the shutters while Frida stands by. Before he started working with her, she had to bring out a chair every evening to reach them. He locks up and hands her the keys. He looks down at her, a head and a half below him. "Bye, Frida. See you in the morning." "Goodbye, Thomas," she says brightly, her smile still a faint echo of what it was when she'd thought he was going to the concert with her. "Thanks for today. Have a good night." The same thing she says to him every time they part. She slips the shop keys into her bulging canvas bag and makes for the lane where she parks her battered Ford van. Her rear view looks defeated. Yellow raincoat, belt trailing, inch of purple skirt below it, flat black sandals. Again he resolves to make a fuss of her in the cafe on Saturday. On the way home, he thinks ahead to the weekend. Wash clothes this evening, get his hair cut late opening tomorrow, remember to bring his bedding and a towel. He wonders what room Mum will put him in. Plenty of choice, with five to pick from. One bathroom between them all is a bit of a bummer, but they'll manage for the few days. They managed during the summer holidays, when the house would often have 10 sleeping in it. You adapted to what you had at your disposal. He'll pick up a couple of six packs of beer. Joe and Aidan drink it too, and food. Mum didn't ask, but he'd like to contribute something. Sausages and rashers, maybe. A few tubs of yogurt. With six to be fed, whatever he brings won't go to waste. Chloe isn't joining them. He'd been secretly hoping she would, ever since Paul told him that she'd been invited. "I don't know what Mum is thinking, asking her along. I'm not going if she is." But Chloe said no. She had other plans for the weekend. Probably just as well. His heart might not survive two nights under the same roof. He reaches the traffic lights and turns left. He passes a hotel, a bus stop, a library. So familiar, all of them, that he hardly sees them anymore. As he walks, he considers the meandering path his life has taken. Working in a cafe had never been part of the plan. But in truth, he never really had a plan, not a proper one. Growing up, he'd had the usual childish dreams. Airline pilot, astronaut, Olympic swimmer, circus acrobat. After seeing the film with Robert Redford, a career as a horse whisperer took over the top slot for about a month. But nothing stayed with him for long enough to turn into a real ambition. He sleepwalked from school into college, hopping from film studies to arts to commerce over the course of two fraught years, much to his parents' dismay. "You need to settle on something," his mother said. "You're not giving any of them a chance." But eventually Thomas realized that it wasn't the courses that were the problem. It was college itself. He wasn't built for it. He wasn't the right fit to be a student. The fault didn't lie with the study. He didn't mind that. It was the various deadlines that undid him. They'd loom in his head, muddying his thinking, pushing known facts out of reach, preventing sleep at night. The more he tried to ignore them, the more they prodded and poked at him, making it more and more difficult to complete each assignment. The other side of college, the social side, wasn't for him either. He'd never been good in crowds, never comfortable mixing with more than one or two at a time. In primary school, he'd been virtually friendless, his quiet demeanor singling him out for attention from the bullies, which only caused him to withdraw further into himself, shutting out even the boys who meant him no harm, who might have become his friends if he'd allowed them to. Secondary school had been better when Sam materialized, their shared passion for chess drawing them into a friendship. But separated from Sam in college, He felt again like the solitary young boy of his childhood, surrounded by laughing, chattering others, and lacking the wherewithal to join them. In the 2 years he'd spent trying to be a student, he hadn't made a single real friend. He'd avoided the discos and pubs his fellow students frequented, opting instead for long walks or solitary movies after he closed his books each day. Sometimes, an entire week of lectures would go by without anyone at all interacting with him. He told himself he was happier left alone, and on one level he was. But with nothing much to distract him from his studies, the days dragged by, and his future, when he dared to consider it, seemed bleak. Commerce, his third course option, was rapidly becoming as uninviting as his previous choices. No third time lucky for him, and nothing else on the syllabus appealed. Finally, he confided in Sam, who'd moved straight from school into a management position in his uncle's car dealership, where he'd been working part-time since the age of 16. "Leave," Sam said immediately. "If it's making you miserable, stop doing it. Figure out what you really want and go for it." Easier said than done. Easy for Sam, who'd come out at 18 to his family. He'd confided in Thomas before that and sworn him to secrecy. Easy for Sam, who'd sold a used Porsche to Matt when he was 19 and moved in with him a few weeks after their first encounter. Easy for Sam, for whom doors seemed to open without him having to knock on them. It had taken Thomas a few more years, and many more wrong turns. Bicycle courier, theatre front of house, call centre operator, hospital porter, before he figured out what he really wanted. Then again, it wasn't so much...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.